Howdy, folks. My name's Glenn, and you've made your way to the Cactus Atlas, and today we're going to be exploring the wonders of Colorado National Monument. Let me just read a little bit from here to you to tell you what we're going to be experiencing here on this episode. Colorado National Monument preserves one of the grandest landscapes of the American West. Bold, big, and brilliantly colored, this plateau and canyon country with its towering masses of naturally sculpted rock embraces 32 square miles of rugged terrain. Here you can contemplate the glorious views that stretch to distant horizons. Discover solitude deep in a remote canyon, blah, blah, blah. I'm sold. Let's go do this. It seems like the crowds have arrived. I'm seeing more and more cars driving in all of a sudden, but what we're on now is something called Rim Rock Drive, and we took the West Fruita entrance. There's two entrances, I think, to the park. The campground where I'm staying at is closer to the west side here. But I think today on this episode, I just want to drive you through the park from this entrance to the other one, and there's lots of overlooks along the way. And that's what I really want to do, is give you your first introduction into Colorado National Monument. And mine too. This is my first exploration, so this Rim Rock Drive seems to be the ticket that takes us through the heart of this thing. I don't know if there's anywhere to pull over. I wanted to show you where we came from. It looks like this is a little stop here for one car. I want to just catch you guys up on where we came from to start our journey and orient you here before we get into the heart of this thing. So let's go take a quick peek at this, these snow-capped distant mountains and red rocks. All right, we're looking down on a valley there where Interstate 70, somewhere out about midway in that valley, is where we came from. We came from Utah, which is off this direction, out west. So that's facing west. And you really get a nice bird's eye view of the landscape. Grand Junction, Colorado is somewhere out that a ways. And you can actually see already how high we came up. The sign where we took our pictures was down there, and there's the visitor, or I guess the check-in gate where you pay your fee or show your national parks pass. And just look around here at this scenery. You got snow on the mountains in the background, snow in this direction, and I'm wearing a t-shirt. I always have to be on guard for reveals, but came around this corner and that is a fantastic view. Got some really sheer drop-offs off to the right, but I mean, this is giving me the Zion National Park vibe so far. You got really big scales like that here and very similar sandstone coloration that you would see in Zion National Park. And that's why you want to drive slow, as you have lots of people biking out here. And now we're coming back out, facing out towards like the west entrance again, the Fruitan entrance, and we are climbing and climbing and climbing up, up and away. Yeehaw. Wow, this is look, a tunnel. A very small tunnel, but a tunnel. Definitely give me the Zion vibes here, because if you know Zion, you know there's a tunnel there. Much longer tunnel than this, but oh, there's more tunnels. This is tunnelicious. And these bikers, I have a lot of respect for them, because if that were me, I'd be walking my bike up this hill in my current shape. There's just no way. I just can't believe we're still climbing up, up, and up. We've been going up this whole time, really, since the visitor center, nonstop. And just when you thought you couldn't get any higher, we keep going and going. I don't even know what the elevation is around here. And now that we're getting higher up in elevation, no snow, so that's good, because I'm camping. It's actually going to be in the low 80s, I think, as a high today, so kind of warm. And looks like the visitor center is coming up in 1 mile. Check out some more amazing views here. Maybe get one more view. It's called the distant view. So one more view of this valley on the west side before we probably have it where we can't see it anymore. And just looky there, you could see what I think is the Colorado River in down there in the middle of this valley, because we followed it for a while. And we're now probably towards the highest point I think we're gonna get looking over this valley here. Little washed out atmosphere at this time of day, midday, but a bird's eye view nonetheless. This is where I have to simulate drone flights and take you up high, because being a national monument, this is a no drone zone all the way through. So unfortunately, where I would love to fly drones around in these kind of landscapes, it's a no-go. So the hard thing though about sitting here in the car is you can't see what's off to my left, what I was expecting of this place. And as soon as I can pull over, we are going to. There's gotta be a scenic overlook somewhere here where we could pull over. All right, this place, it looks like I had to get my spot because this place is pretty packed with people, but probably one of those things where people just come and go. This probably has the views that I'm looking for to get you started properly here. Let's go scout it out. All right, I lied. Maybe we will do some light hiking here. This is Otto's Trail. It's a quarter mile to the overlook, so half mile total. Nothing bad at all. I keep seeing this guy John Otto's name, who I think was one of the first pioneers that explored this area, and it says, walk in the footsteps of John Otto as you follow the route he used for his first ascent of Independence Monument. We'll have to learn more about this Otto fellow as the day progresses. I know there's some stuff in the pamphlet about him. Kind of curious. And being that the climbs and the type of environment is very similar to other places I've been to in Utah, I wonder if rattlesnakes are now coming out or if they live this high up. I imagine they do. Because we had our first live rattlesnake sighting on the Cactus Atlas at Hovenweep National Monument yesterday, and I got hooked and I want to see more now. And I know some of you think I'm absolutely crazy for saying that. It was a prairie rattler, according to went and talked to the arranger there, and we got an identification book out and identified it based on my pictures. Really small snake, but really beautiful. Here's that canyon that we saw, or we drove around, and campground on the other side, visitor center, and then this like deep chasm here. That's what I couldn't show you as we were rounding the corner. We couldn't find a spot to pull off, but should have just been patient, because here you go. I read in a pamphlet, I think there's some odd like 46 miles of hiking trails in here too. Many of which we're not going to be able to do on my limited time frame. Just here today, overnight, and then in the morning tomorrow. This is where I get into trouble, because I want to stop and just go from side to side and zigzag, when I'm sure the main point is the thing you want to see. I also like to do reveals over really steep, sheer cliffs. Oh God. Oh my God. All right, that's about as close as I'm willing to get, folks. That has to be straight down, perpendicular to the ground. Ay, 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 I don't like that. Oh yeah, Mr. Otto's overlook. It's like facing this way. I would have thunk it would have faced that way with those views, but looks like they want to call your attention out further west, which I could see why. I mean, that is iconic west right here. All right, let me show you what I saw right here. I like taking you guys over the edge because I can hold you over it. Who knows how that comes out on camera? But I guarantee you, if you were here, you'd be holding onto this rail. White knuckle. That is white knuckle. You see that? Now you know what the white knuckle means. I don't do the greatest with heights, although I can man through it. So look at this overlook. I feel like I'm at the top of the world here. Look at this giant formation here. I guess I was wrong. The overlook does orient you here in front of this landscape that Mr. Otto must have crapped his pants when he saw this. Maybe he crapped his pants by walking up. because he didn't have a car or a truck like I do. Probably would have just been bushwhacking it or maybe using ancient trails. So what do you guys think? This might be the best views of 2023 on the Cactus Atlas so far. I might have to call it already, and I feel like we just got started here. So much more to do and see. And I could just stay right here all day long. This is really fantastic in this, you know, this formation here. Take a look at it, you can kind of see, I guess this guy back in the day started a tradition on Independence Day, I think that's Independence Monument, where he would climb this route up the rocks up here to the very top to place an American flag on top of that thing. Mr. Otto, you are a man, a man's man. And it says modern day climbers typically do the same route. Unfortunately, it's kind of backlit now, but you can actually see the route, his route to get up to the top of that. I wonder if he did it with ropes and stuff, or did he just freehand that? I don't even know. We don't really have time to get into Mr. Otto's story, but I want to know more about him after reading that. All right, so now we're really getting into the rim here. I've had a little bit of a cell signal. I'm getting text messages up here, which I wasn't expecting. Here's another overlook. This is Independence Monument View. I think in honor of Mr. Otto, we need to stop here and ponder his climbing. And the monument looks very different from this angle, I think, from what we just saw. Interesting. Man, I don't know how many overlooks there are gonna be, but this could be a long video because they're all worth stopping at. I'm all by my lonesome here. I'm getting lonely. Not really, I love it. Oh, here's some information about people climbing that dang thing. And they had ropes. And here's a picture of Otto doing it. You gotta be kidding me. I think it's right there. It looks a lot thinner from this angle than what we saw over there. We were just out there at the peak at the end of that when we walked out about a quarter mile. You could see the parking lot. I'd see a white van off in the distance, and then you just walk out to the end of that. Not hard at all. Highly recommended. Man, this is nuts. I'm just trying to imagine people climbing that in general. Otto or anybody even today, I commend you. Although I kind of have to say, I think the view was a little better from out there. That was the premier view so far. Because that right here just looks a little skinnier than what it looks like from the side. But still, the overall landscape is just phenomenal. Being able to see as far off as you can. Wow. All right. Well, let's continue here. I'm sure there's going to be many more places to stop. It's almost like you're flying, though. I love this drive. I mean, you are on top of the world up here, and you have these views in your right in your face this whole time. Wow, more spots. And it's like this is facing a different direction now. So what do we have here? The Grand View. With a name like that, how are you not going to stop? I mean, come on. Now we're on the other side of Monument, Independence Monument. And from this angle, you could see the flat face again. Oh wow, we're heading out to that little spot right there overlooking all of this stuff. Wowzers. This is just mind-boggling, my friends. The distances you can see, the heights. But if you don't like heights, you know, it's a pretty on the rails experience, and you can't really fall if you don't do something stupid and stay on the trail. But I could see for some, this might be a little much. It just looks scary. Just don't look down, that's my best advice, but it's impossible not to because we're on the top of the world here. Look at that. Just look at that. I thought we may have seen the best already, and we were gonna start with the best first, but You can't say that here. You just can't say that. And you can see the Rimrock Drive up there where we've been coming, and you see water melting, glistening in the sun, the snow melt, miniature waterfalls, and all of these box canyons down here. This is I don't even know. You can even see trails down there that you can hike, which I would love to do if we have time. So it's not just the rock formations on their own that create the dazzle. It's just that, and then turning your head in combination with these crazy views. It's all of that together that does it, because, you know, if you want to see stuff like this, you know, go to Zion, go to Monument Valley, you got your choices, but I don't know if you have something with the views like that to go with it. I like this too, because you can really keep track of where you've been. You know, we were out that way, I think, on that point. Maybe now two. I maybe have lost track. I can see where the visitor center is, but I know we were on the other side of that. You know, we saw it from the other face and saw the route that Otto took to climb up that, and where modern climbers do that. Wish there was somebody climbing it today and we could like zoom in, but I didn't see anybody or spot anybody doing that. But another look at Independence Monument. There are like three hawks or eagles flying together as a group. I don't know if I picked it up, but it's probably the same birds we see right here. I'm gonna guess it was one of these guys. Was it a golden eagle? Is that what those were? There's three of them. They're way on the other side now. Maybe they're actually vultures. I don't know if eagles travel in groups, do they? I know somebody out there knows the answer to that. This is where I wish I had the power to mind meld with animals and then see the view from the perspective of an eagle. And I always like to say I'd listen to Iron Maiden, specifically The Flight of Icarus. It would be the proper choice of song to accompany seeing life through the eyes of an eagle. Alrighty, so that was the grand view. I looked at the map to see how far are we on this Rimrock Drive. Not quite halfway done. But I think we're at some point there's gonna be like some spread out areas where we're gonna get more driving done and not as much of a concentration of overlooks. Although there's still plenty to see, and there's one at the end called the Cold Shivers overlook. So I'm really curious to see why they call it that. So we kind of came around a bend, and I see there's much more monument to explore and see. And I thought we had seen it all already, but I don't think we did. We still have a ways to go here. All right, we are wrapping around. I think I might see another vantage point with views we have not even seen yet. Everyone is different, like I've been telling you. This might be the Coke Ovens overlook. Or that, or Monument Canyon overlook, I'm not sure yet. This would be the Coke Ovens overlook. So there was another overlook called Monument overlook that I briefly parked at, thinking it was something, but it was really obstructed view from, unless I just totally missed out, but may have missed one of them. But let's go check out the Coke Ovens. This is a cool feature that I read about. I think there's a trail that might even be down there somewhere that I want to do. I think we just have to walk right down here to get a look at it. But yeah, I think those are the Coke Ovens down that way. And you see many trails down in the valley. I still haven't figured out how you get down there. I don't know if you have to descend these cliffs to get down there, or if there are access points down at ground level. But anyway, the Coke Ovens are beautiful. Much larger than they look like in pictures. They probably look pretty small to you too. going to give you one of those vertigo-inducing shots here. Although it does, it kind of levels off, but even right here is kind of a pretty nice drop off. And then it kind of goes out to the edge and drops off again. But I don't know if you can see the scales because the trees get smaller and smaller. So that's one thing I like about it visually, is the little trees get smaller and smaller and give some scale to everything here. At least it does here in person, witnessing it with a naked eye. Yeah, I bet you there's so many different directions that you can face on these overlooks. So some of them must be really good for sunrise or sunset opportunities. It's unfortunate because I am here. It's about 1 o'clock, I think. Let's see what time it is. 1:07. So I've been making really good time through here. So I'm gonna guess this isn't a full day type of thing doing the rim drive, unless you hike and walk and take your time. I'm sure you can make it as long as you'd want to make it. But my suspicion is we're gonna continue. You can kind of see where the road goes. And I wouldn't be surprised if it kind of winds back down that way and there's another east entrance or exit, however you want to look at it, that we can go seek out. But the coke ovens. Now here's another one. This is more my speed, one car here, and they're leaving. You see my luck? Only one other car here. Let's get out and take a look. See what this is. This is called the Artist's Point. Anytime you see something called the Artist's Point, or you hear that in a lot of different parks, Death Valley has one, usually there's a good reason for it. I have high expectations. And woo doggy, is it windy up here at Artist's Point today. This is the windiest spot of all, maybe because we're even up higher than before. But the temperature feels the same. Let's see why they call this the Artist's Point. I have high expectations here. A palette of color. That would make sense. Oh, neat. That's a really interesting formation right there. It is very colorful, but it probably could be more colorful in different light. Sunrise, sunset earlier. I'm not sure, but I actually think I see the overlook proper. It's down there, so we might have another little hike to do. I don't know how we get down there though. Alrighty, so here is the overlook access. So I think that person's coming back up now too, so we should have it to ourselves. We're doing good. Wait a second. This is where I just was. So how do they get down there? That's the magic trail, I guess. Let's do some reconnaissance. Where did that person go? Very weird. Must be on the other side. There is an overlook over here. I see a waterfall, actually. Neat. All right, so if this is the Artist's Point, now I see why. I was gonna say it's nice, but with a waterfall to boot? Come on. I was not expecting waterfalls today, so that is a very pleasant surprise. And then all you gotta do is just turn back this ways and look. So I'm glad I came over here and looked at that, because that'd be easy to miss, that waterfall. But now I want to figure out how you get down to that other part of the overlook where I saw someone hanging about down there. You know, all the little overlooks are very easily accessible. Not in terms of ADA accessibility, I just meant not far from the road, but yeah, they have little steps built in, and the slick rock, as they call it, the sandstone is not as slick as you think. it grips. The hard thing is like the loose dirt on top. But, oh no, there's some people up there and they kind of came down a little ways, but they opted not to come all the way down. Their loss. I think this is probably the artist point proper, because they talk about lots of different color and stuff, and I think the colors pop in a lot more on this side. I see why they call this the artist point. There is a lot of color, a lot of different reds, green. I love how you have like the more up close pines and junipers here. And really photogenic. Basically, we can see the rim road where we came from. That's facing kind of what, northwest, I would guess. And you can almost see like proto arches starting to form in the landscape there, reminiscent of Arches National Park once again. But yeah, this is superb. And you know, you got the mountain in the background with the mesa with the snow on it. I'm sitting here trying to think what my favorite view has been today. A little out of breath, I just got back in the car. A little high elevation here too, but I honestly can't pick one. I really can't. So far, every single one has had something unique to offer. So in this section, there are more overlooks. Ute Canyon, really deep canyon off to our left, red sandstone. I'm going to, actually, you know what? I am gonna stop here. I saw something that made me, I was like, I'm gonna just maybe not stop, but I see another fenced off overlook, which means usually there's a really steep, scary thing to see, and now I see why this is worthy of an overlook. So yes, this one is worthy of stopping. I skipped one back there, didn't look as interesting. The one I skipped, just in case, you guys can comment down below and let me know if I missed something. It was the Upper Ute Canyon Overlook. This one I think is the Fallen Rock Overlook. And then shortly we should hit the tallest spot in the park. I bet you it's that hill off to the left of your screen right now. Anyway, let's go check out this Fallen Rock Overlook. All right, another overlook temporarily to myself here. Neat. Wow, that is a pretty sight. With the snow on this side. And those people are passing it up. Look at that. You can actually see here too what this place can look like blanketed in snow. Here it's partially in snow. It's been melting with this warmer air. I believe this will be Ute Canyon, and there's a big feature, and that's why they call it Fallen Rock, is right there. It says it's a slow fall. So maybe over time it's like so heavy and big it's just sinking into the earth, I assume is what it means. And then over this way is that canyon, Ute Canyon, that goes back that a ways. So we could have looked down into that, but I'm gonna be a little bit more choosy from here on out, just for sake of time and not to fatigue you guys. Now that I'm taking in the view, I'm glad I stopped here though. I like the view down that canyon. Is my favorite part. The Falling Rock's pretty cool too, but I just like that. I'd like to hike down there. Once again, all the snow on those mesas behind us. So here I'm going to skip this one. This should be Ute Canyon Overlook. And I'm looking off to the left and it's pretty, but it's not as unique as some of the earlier on things we've seen today. So that's why I'm kind of just being a little judicious about this, and I'm looking at it right now. I think we're okay to skip it. I don't want to give you the idea that it's not pretty. It is, but it's not as cool as I think the front of the park and more snow-capped landscapes to see too. And this must be Red Canyon on my left, another one we're gonna probably skip. I'm gonna pull in here and give you guys a quick look. It's just hard to say, like, I want to stop at every single thing. Okay, fine, I gotta stop. I gotta stop. This one's framed really nicely with that really deep valley down below, so. And it says it's a canyon within a canyon, a double canyon. That's almost as good as a double rainbow. Here's a look at your canyon inside of a canyon. I don't really see it. I just see a canyon here. But I love the way it just frames the valley behind it, where the Colorado is probably lurking, and then those snow-capped mesas again. See, it's pretty, I told you. Maybe not worth overanalyzing at this point. But I would say one of the premier views of the day, just because of the way it's framed. They call it a canyon within a canyon. And I still am not really getting it. Apparently that's Grand Junction right below too, Grand Junction, Colorado. So Grand Junction is right here. So how about you guys out there, what do you know about this area of Colorado, Grand Junction? Is it a good place to live? Certainly location-wise it is. If you have this here, number one. Number two, you're not far from Moab, Utah, and all of that stuff, and other areas in Utah, my favorite places in the country. So Amy, maybe we need to start researching. Yeah, it's just one of these places that, it's something about these sandstone landscapes that just does it to me. Maybe it's the sun and the warmth emanating off of the sandstone. It just always fills me with a feeling of well-being. Anytime I'm around red rocks, I don't know why. All right, I think the next thing I'm seeking out is the Cold Shivers Overlook. Hopefully I didn't build it up for you and I both, and then it's gonna be like, wah, wah, wah. I have to imagine though. If it doesn't give me cold shivers, I'm gonna go complain at the visitor center to the Rangers and say, you need to rename it. Because you can't name stuff like that and then not deliver. It's just not fair. And here we are, as advertised, Cold Shivers Point. I don't know why they call it that yet. I honestly couldn't deduce from the road. So let's go see if this lives up to its name. Maybe it's because it's a steep drop-off, maybe it's because the views. Or maybe neither. The wind has got a little bit of a coolness to it, but it's not a cold. I'm not shivering. And even though there's a car over there, I don't see anybody over here. So have I managed it once again? Have we hit every overlook today without anybody here? I mean, I guess people have come towards the end, but what is this all about here? All right, so it looks like we have two different views maybe. This one is just looking up one of these canyons. Maybe Red Canyon, I don't know. Is it Red Canyon? It's one of the names of the canyons I've seen. And then let's turn this way and see. Ooh, maybe that's why. Maybe it's the height where this thing got its name. I mean, it is pretty high up, but not as high as some of the other ones we've seen today. So I don't think we'd call it Cold Shivers due to height, although it's plenty high. You could say bye-bye if you dropped anything down there or you fell. Oh, I think I get it. I think to get the cold shivers, you have to walk out on that and then balance yourself and do like a crane kick pose from the Karate Kid on that. And no, you will not be seeing that today. But, or maybe replicate the Titanic where they're like on the front of the ship on the edge of the world. But I do think we can walk out here a little ways because I do think this is giving me some tingles. Maybe not cold shivers, maybe cold tingles. You know, I like my explanation the best though, because to be honest with you, so far, you know, unless the view out here is better, I would say this is on par with most of what we've seen today and not the best. But once again, it's really hard to say best or not best when you're in a place like this. It's like complaining about on Christmas getting presents, you know? Although I guess some presents are better than others. So we could apply that same logic here. And you know people have been out there. I'm sure you can go on Instagram and see people balanced on that, but forget it for me. Although maybe on this part, add a little bit of adventure to our day. Now this is really cool. If that's dated accurately, that's from 1939. Wongs. The Wongs, I presume. And there's like a, is that like Chinese symbol? Does anybody read Chinese? Or one of the dialects of Chinese? I don't know what that is. That looks like May 4th of 1939. And many others have left their marks here. I see a 1983 on this. And I don't know, one day this is going to be antique stuff. Some of it already is, 1990. There's some kind of marker over here too. Oh my God, I get dizzy. It's like when I see, like my mind sees the solid rock and out of the periphery I see movement and it's just, I know it's straight down. So I guess I'll give it to it. It does have a cold shiver because of the danger, I guess. But at the same time, view-wise, it's beautiful, but I don't know. Maybe it just gets cold up here. It is starting to get windy. Let's come on this side over here. It's just, the thing I don't like too is like when you have these like drop-offs with my already slight vertigo I have, it's the wind, the gusts. Not that it really budges me, but it's freaky, you know? You can see my shadow. I'm very cautiously putting you over the edge, but I'm staying far back, so. I already see, right now I have tingles and I am a good 3 or 4 feet from the edge. And there's more graffiti here too, like August 25th of 1959. All right, I think I'm gonna make a guess and say the cold shivers got its name from the straight drops and the ledges you could probably hang your feet over if you were brave enough. I am not. View-wise, it's, you know, how are you gonna beat it in general? But when you compare it to the other offerings here, I would say cold shivers. I'll just say it this way, it's not my favorite of them, but it's still freaking amazing. You know, when I hear cold shivers though, I am slightly disappointed by the naming of this. I think it's definitely worth naming it something, but the only way I'm gonna give you the cold shivers is if you go out on that thing and do what I said. Otherwise, I'm gonna call it cool shivers. All right. I don't want any of you to hear what I said, especially you kids. Do not go out on that. I will not be responsible for your death. Alrighty, folks, we went in one entrance and out the other. We did the Rimrock Drive, complete, checked off. I hope you enjoyed that as much as I did. That was mind-blowing. Hopefully you'll have a chance to visit this in your lifetime too, and check out some of our other content on Colorado National Monument. I will see you next time.